So our next chat this afternoon is with a gentleman called Markus Stitz. From September 2015 to August 2016, adventurer, photographer and single speed bike enthusiast Markus Stitz completed his around the world cycle on a single speed bicycle, covering a total distance of 34,097 kilometres through 26 countries, all in the same gear. Originally from Germany, Stitz is now based in Edinburgh, and when he's not cycling, works in marketing. An experienced long-distance cyclist, Stitz devised the 150-mile Capital Trail bikepacking route through East Lothian, the Lammermoor Hills, the Borders and the Pentland Hills. The route made its debut at the Edinburgh Festival of Cycling in 2015, and also in 2015 he was named Bikepacker to Watch by Bikepackers magazine. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Markus Stitz.
Hello.
I'm loving the branding on the top. That's fantastic. Do you wear that all the time or just at events like this?
I quite like it actually. It's a merino top, so I wear it quite often, but not too often. Something underneath as well. So.
Right. 26 countries, 34,097 kilometres. Let's just start with what was the toughest kilometre of that? 34,097?
That's a good question, actually. Possibly leaving Edinburgh. I think, kind of in a sense of, if you head off on a trip like this, and I had no real expectation where if I'm going to be able to make it or not, I think the first day was possibly the toughest day because I just chucked my key in the letterbox and left, and I knew there was no return. And I also left really, really late on the first day. I had a few issues, and yeah, it was quite a tough thing once you head off, and then you kind of leave everything behind. But the other bit, and I think just further on the road, is cycling a long, flat road in the outback of Australia. And I had one day where I was really struggling with a headwind, and that was possibly the hardest kilometer I ever had, and getting back on the bike and just kind of like picking myself up, and it was actually just about a year ago when I did that.
Right, so the Nullarbor Plain in Australia, going from Perth towards Adelaide, kind of way, from west to east, is that the way that you did it?
I did it the other way around. So right. I did Australia from Sydney to Perth.
Okay.
Against the recommendation of a lot of people. So if you look at my trip, I basically cycled the other way around, like other people do it. So I went to the States first and then New Zealand, Australia. So I started in Sydney and went to Perth. And it was the Nullarbor is a tough road because when you stand on the middle of the road, you see the horizon bending down on both sides. And that on a single speed bike is something really tough because people were looking at me and some people stopped on the way and they said, oh, you must be really, really fast, because it kind of looked like I'm going really fast because I have to spin a lot. And then I basically said to them, no, I'm not fast at all. I'm doing 22, 23 kilometers an hour. That's about it. And that was the absolute maximum I could do on a long flat road. So
I'm intrigued that you went from Sydney to Perth.
Yeah.
Reason being is that most people do it the opposite way around, because as you say, most people go towards the east when they do a circumnavigation. But for everybody else, they are the ones having the headwinds going from Perth to Sydney because the prevailing wind is coming against you. So you were incredibly unlucky to have a headwind going towards Perth.
Yes, and fingers crossed. I only had one really bad day on the Nullarbor, and that was when I had a northwesterly wind, which was straight in my face. The other times, I had a southeasterly most of the times, which is... talking about the wind, I never, like in all the things I do, I don't really think about this. Because I think if you start planning with headwinds and rain and all sorts of conditions you can get, you kind of get yourself in a state where you try to find excuses not to do something. So I literally just left going around the world, and I didn't really care that much where the prevailing wind comes from or not, because you'll find in any country you've got good and bad days. You've got days where you've got a really nice tailwind and it just everything goes to plan and goes smooth, and okay. Then sometimes not.
Okay, so you never thought about the wind What did you think about when you came up with the idea, I'm going to ride around the world on a single speed bike with no gears?
I love the simplicity. So the way all of this came about is I wasn't really a cyclist up until 2006 when I jumped on a mountain bike pretty much for the first time. And then I moved to Scotland in 2009, and I had done a lot of cycling in New Zealand. And back in that time is when single speed bikes kind of came back being fashionable. A lot of cycle couriers used them over where I lived in Wellington. And but I always felt like it's a stupid idea to ride with just one gear. I loved gears up to then. And then I did a trip cycling home to Germany in 2010 in the middle of winter from Edinburgh to Germany. And I just wanted a bike that is simple. So I didn't want anything that can break. And again, no excuses to kind of stop the journey. And I bought a single speed bike overnight and rode it home to Germany. And ever since then, I've been basically riding on one gear because I just liked the simplicity. And when it came to doing the trip around the world, I felt like I've just spent 5 years cycling on the single speed bike. Why would I? And I really enjoyed it. Why would I take something else and take something which is I don't really have any experience with? So,
choosing which gear to put on your bike must have been a tricky thing to do right at the very, very beginning. So, what is the gear each on your bike?
So on this one, that's not me. Doesn't matter. I've used a 30-18 ratio. The bike's over there at the stand if people want to have a look at it. It's at the Cycle Law Scotland stand. So 32 on the front is basically what used to be the middle chainring on a mountain bike when there are three chainrings, and it's kind of the big chainring now. And on the back, the decision was made easy because I was sponsored by Halo and they only had a freewheel in 16, 17 and 18 tooth. So I kind of had to find something that suits me in that range. So I went for 18 because it was the highest I could find in that range. And I did cycle with the bike before I left around the world quite a few months beforehand just to figure out if I can get up hills, and figured out it seems to be all right. And it's the best ratio I could find to go around the world. It's fine to go up hills. That was the most crucial thing. And it is very spinny on the flat bits, so on the Nullarbor, as I said, people were looking at me and thinking I'm going overly fast, but I literally didn't. But it was still fast enough to make it over the flat bits.
What kind of frame is it that you've got on the bike? Is it a road bike frame, a cross frame, a mountain bike?
It's a Surly Opera, so it's sold as a mountain bike, if you look at it, has a really upright seating position, which I really enjoyed because it made the whole thing. If you spend 200 kilometers a day sometimes on the bike, you want to be comfortable. You want to be as upright for me as I could be. And I also chose the bike because it had mounts on the frame where I could put my cages on the front fork and whatever I needed to fit on the frame. So. Steel frame, again, like the whole bike was pretty much steel all over, and simple but very effective and really comfortable to ride.
It appears that round the world cyclists always have a major moment of heartache or trauma when they're going across North America. You had a similar situation when your father passed away. Can you tell us what it was like having you get back on the bike after that? How did you cope with it?
Tough, I think you named it, and it wasn't made easier by the fact that when I went back to the United States after being a month off, it was minus 15 at night, so it was not the sort of conditions I would ever imagine cycling in. I think the thing that made it easy in North America is that people are really curious, and they're really, Americans, I found them very, very hospitable, and generally interested in what I was doing. It's also having this attitude of being quite excitable about things. So there are people coming up and they looked at the bike. I mean, over all the world, the bike is possibly not what people normally cycle around the world. So people were just naturally curious and just asking questions what I was doing. And so that made it easier. And I think in a sense, for me, what got me back on the bike was having my family basically said to me, look, we want you to go out there again, we want you to continue to write and finish what you were attempting to do, and with that backing behind, it was not easy, but it was manageable to go out there. And also for me, I had lived in New York for about 7 weeks in 2005, and I did a working holiday in the States. So by the time I came to Arizona and California, those are places I actually had been to, and it was amazing cycling over. So I started again in Gallup in New Mexico. I cycled across Arizona, and I remember the last time I was there, I was driven in this big American motorhome by someone who had given me a lift, and then sitting on this simple, really, I don't know, you don't have much on a bike, but still being able to cover those distances in the desert there was a fascinating thing.
What did you have on the bike? What equipment did you have to take with you?
All I needed, I would say. I was basically self-sufficient for being out for a year. So I had a tent, sleeping mattress, sleeping bag. I had my kitchen, so I had pots and the stove to cook my own food. I had a dynamo on the front so I could charge my electric devices. Enough clothes to layer up. I think the trick to all of this is to take as much as you need, but don't take anything extra, because everything you take extra will be extra weight and less enjoyment on the bike. I also had a spot tracker so people could track the journey, and I had a safety device with that as well. What else did I have? Some tools as well, but not too many, so I didn't plan for the worst case scenario on the bike, and it never really happened anyway. So yeah, enough to live, and my iPhone was my office for a year, so it was, yeah.
And food and water would have been the most important thing. So when you're going across Arizona and when you're going across the Nullarbor, that would be two places where you're going to have to carry a lot. What was it? Either in distance or in time, what was the biggest gap you had between shops, basically, between buying one lot of food and buying the next lot of food?
So in terms of food, I actually don't know. But in terms of water, the longest distance I had was 210 kilometers. There was again in the Nullarbor. So if you look at the Nullarbor, it's about 1,600 kilometers to get across there. And there is nothing really other than a small town at the beginning and a small town at the end. And I wouldn't really call that a town. It's kind of like a glorified village with a shop. Anything that has a shop in Australia is kind of a town anyway. And in between there are road houses, which have very simple food and water. So 210 kilometers was the longest there. And in order to get across there, in Australia, I had a camelback on my bike with 3 liters. So that normally got me across a day. Normally, I've trained myself to drink quite efficiently beforehand, so I could cover certain distances without any food and water if I needed to. The whole thing wasn't made the easiest by the fact that I'm vegetarian, and I don't know if anyone's ever been to Australia or to the US. They're possibly not embracing vegetarians as much as they do in other countries. So in Australia, I basically had enough food with me for 3 days normally on the bike. There was muesli bars, there was like whatever dried food you can find, and just is takes up very little space on the bike. And I had another 4 liters of water extra in Australia, just as a backup supply if I get stuck somewhere in the middle of nowhere. So I could kind of like live for 2 or 3 days. I think the thing I found particularly challenging in the US sometimes is that you'll have, and in the desert as well, it's possibly not so much not getting food, it's just you look ahead and you can't see anything changing. Like basically the horizon stays the same for a number of days, and there's absolutely no change, so that's quite a challenging thing. But I made it.
What was the most surprising country you went through?
I think, in a sense, Iran was the biggest surprise for me. I had chatted to a couple of people who've done similar routes beforehand, and they all said to me that the people in Iran are very, very hospitable, and it's a fascinating country as well. But I was blown away by how friendly the people were and how supportive. And it's also, I guess it's, if you go to Western countries, you've got tourist infrastructure. Even in the Nullarbor in Australia, you have roadhouses that have rooms. They're not comfortable. They have a bed and a shower, but that's about it. In Iran, you don't really have any of that other than in big towns. So if you come to a small village, there isn't a guest house, there isn't the people. People take you into their private homes and they feed you and I didn't even speak their language, and a lot of people don't speak English at all. So the way to communicate was with hands and feet and showing them pictures. And that was a really, really interesting experience to have that. So A, communicating without being able to understand the other person, and also the mixture of the, it's a stunning country with some wonderful regions, and also the hospitality of the people there, that made it a huge surprise for me.
Was the reason you went, let's say, the wrong way round, because you knew you had to do America and you wanted to do Iran, but if you'd done it the other way, you would have had difficulties physically getting into America, having been in Iran previously?
Actually, I never thought about that, but I think possibly that would have been the deciding factor. Once you've got an Iranian visa and your passport, you have to apply for a visa in America. So, to be honest with you, when I attempted the trip, I had a rough itinerary in my head where I wanted to go, but it was a very spontaneous experience. So I kept on planning in 2 week intervals. And obviously sometimes you have to book a flight to get from a continent to another one, so you have to do that a little bit more in advance. But other than that, I was just literally trying to get as many local advice as possible, and not having too much of an idea in my head, and that was the beauty of the whole trip, actually.
What was it like when you finally got back to Scotland?
It was an interesting experience. I really enjoyed my last 5 days in Scotland. So I came over with a little ferry from Northern Ireland onto Islay and landed in Port Ellen, which was very, very, and then the weather was horrendous that day. It was windy, so I'm getting seasick very, very quickly. So I sat in the boat for 2 hours and just kind of came off the boat and was like, I was so glad that the journey on that boat was over. It was absolutely, I really enjoyed it, because it was kind of just confirmed my view of Scotland is a beautiful country to cycle. And the welcome from the people was great as well. I stayed in a couple of hostels because I couldn't be bothered with the midges in the Highlands. So it's just kind of, that's the one thing I did not enjoy. But other than that, it was nice. And then being back in Edinburgh, I guess, was a weird experience, because you wake up the next morning and you've been on your bike for a whole year. And basically the routine is you cycle the whole day, you have something to eat, you find a place to sleep, and then you go to bed and you wake up for breakfast. And I think if you then wake up after having done that for a year, and all of a sudden you kind of go like, well, you know, I don't need to quit my bike. It's an interesting feeling.
Nowadays, you're known for creating the bikepacking routes. What makes Scotland so good for bikepacking compared to other countries? Why are you pushing for us to get out on our bikes more, but with all the kit, and to go explore into the wilderness?
There's a couple of things. The access laws are brilliant. So in Scotland, and that's quite unique, I haven't found another country in the world, you can go wherever you want to and you can cycle. So you're not just confirmed to some routes you can take, you can go wherever you want to, as long as you do that in a sustainable way. And that makes it quite, there's also a fascinating network of old heritage paths. So military roads, coffin roads, whatever, there's an interesting website where you can find all of those paths. And so there's a lot of infrastructure actually there, and then the mountain bike centers and the off-road routes. You can camp anywhere for a night, and then I've just been speaking to Jeff Allen, who's written a book on all the boffies. So there's a network of about, I think, 90 or 100 boffies where you can stay in. So all of this together makes it a brilliant destination for, especially for off-road cycling, because you can. And the thing I did really appreciate, and I think this is a thing we don't really think about here, fresh water. This is the country where you will find fresh water pretty much everywhere. Whereas if you've been to the desert, there is nothing. You know, I think if you go across Australia, you can't just cycle off and explore somewhere. You have to be really, really mindful of the fact that you might end up in not having, whereas in Scotland you can drink pretty much from every stream, or if you're in a build a barrier, you will find water as well, obviously. So that makes it a pretty nice country to travel.
So for anyone who might have been inspired by what you've done, what advice would you give them for starting off, getting into to bike packing with gears or single speed?
I think one single advice, don't overplan. So if you want to do it, just get some kit and get out there and figure out if you like it or not. There's a couple of, I've just set up a website called bikepackingscotland.com. There will be a couple of routes on there which you can cycle. The Capital Trail, for example, is a good route to get into it. And just for me, the thing, and I was going around the world, I've got a big thing about it. It needs to be fun. You need to enjoy what you're doing. So don't start off and do something which is overly ambitious and you don't enjoy it. Do something small. And if you see you enjoy it, do something a little bit bigger and just work your way gradually through that. And I also, for me, which I really appreciated having gone around the world by myself, is just get some good mates or get your family and get them out there. Take a couple of people. It's mainly more enjoyable to go out there on the bike with a couple of people other than by yourself. And yeah, just kind of try it.
Excellent. Ladies and gentlemen, does anyone have any questions for Markus? Yeah.
So, like, obviously you go to some pretty dark places whenever you're cycling from that point of time. What would you say gets you through whenever you're sort of feeling pretty tough about your day?
The thing that worked really well for me is having the... Whenever I had a tough stretch, I was really looking forward to meet people somewhere along the way again. I think if you look at the trip, it was... When I started off, it was about the cycling, and I thought, I'm going to go around the world, I'm going to do this amazing cycling trip. And I had some amazing stretches where I cycled, but I think the thing that I've taken away from the trip is I met amazing people along the way, and whenever I had a bit of a downtime, I was just kind of trying to pick myself up and say, you know, just keep going, and at the end of the road, there will be something, and it was a massive learning experience for me, especially after the thing that happened with my dad and between as well. You wouldn't expect that to happen. Just kind of hold on. And I think one thing on a practical sort of thing, I try to treat every day as its own entity. So whenever you have a really bad day, the likeliness that the next day is going to be better is very high, because things normally can only get better. It's very, very unlikely that you have a really bad day and then you have another day which is even worse on the other side. So just try to go to sleep and just make a cut and wake up the next morning and go out there with fresh energy.
Thank you. Anyone else? No? Well, Markus, thank you very, very much. If you want to hear more in-depth stuff about what Markus has been up to, he's done a presentation at Craigdon Mountain Sports in Edinburgh on the 16th of March, so if you're from that side of the country, then please feel free to make your way there. But ladies and gentlemen, please show your appreciation for Markus Stitz.